Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum, my dear respectful viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon you. Hello and welcome to the 32nd episode of the Treatise of Rights series. Today we will discuss the right of property. Regarding this, Imam Al-Sajjad Zain al-Abidin alayhi salam has said, "And the right of your property is that you should not attain it except by legitimate means, and you should only spend it for legitimate causes. You should not spend it improperly, you should not use it wrongfully, and you should only use what is from God in His way and as a means to approach Him. In it, your property, you should not prefer above yourself one who does not show gratitude to you, and in fact will neither use your legacy well nor use it in obedience to your Lord. In that case, you will be an aid to him or in that. Or you may bequeath your property to one who spends it in the way of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in ways better than you do so. Then he will gain the benefits and he will be left with the sins, the regret and the remorse together with the ill consequences. And there is no power but in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." We can summarize the Imam's words as follows. The source of wealth is God. Therefore, wealth must be spent in his way. Wealth should be used wisely. Otherwise, it will be left as inheritance. The inheritors might use it properly and gain the related benefits of this world and the hereafter. The loss might be left for the one who earned it in the first place. Wealth is not stable. It might belong to us one day and belong to others later. We read in the following Holy Quran, "Wealth and sons are allurements of the life of this world." The Holy Quran, chapter 18, verse 46. "This world is so temporary. Everything we own and even ourselves shall return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Before going into this topic any further, let's take a look at the types of ownership that we have. There are two forms of ownership, true ownership and virtual ownership. True ownership is the form of ownership in which the owner has absolute control over the things he owns. Examples include the ownership of the cause over the effect or the mind over imagination. God is the true owner of all things, as we can see in the following verse. "But to God belong all things in the heavens and on earth, and He it is that encompasseth all things." The Holy Quran, chapter 4, verse 126. True ownership cannot be transferred from the owner. However, virtual ownership is the form of ownership in which the owner can use the property and prevent other people from using it. This is like the ownership of man over his wealth. This form of ownership has been developed through the social association of people with one another. That is why it is called virtual. There is no true developmental relationship between the owner and the property. This form of ownership is transferable. We can sense that without a doubt there is a difference between our ownership and Allah's ownership. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created man and made him the center of this universe. Everything that happens surrounds humans and their needs. The Holy Quran counts the blessings and considers them to be for man's use, as we can read in the following verse. "It is He who hath created for you all things that are on earth." The Holy Quran, Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 29. Also consider the following verse in this regard. "Do ye not see that God has subjected to your use all things in the heavens and on earth?" The Holy Quran, chapter 31, verse 20. And the following verse. "It is He who hath produced you from the earth and settled you therein." The Holy Quran, chapter 11, verse 61. And the following. "Give them something yourselves out of the means which God has given to you." The Holy Quran, chapter 24, verse 33. Thus, we see that God, subhanahu wa ta'ala, has given man a central role in creation, and everything is created for man. God has created everything, including wealth, for man's benefit. The economic system is an important part of the overall Islamic system. It has been set up to meet man's basic needs, such as food, clothing, housing, defense, recreation, health and hygiene, as well as his psychological needs, such as man's desire for beauty. When humans were placed into this world, they had many options and decisions to make. This includes how they choose to spend or interact with worldly means. Many verses in the Holy Quran view this world as play and amusement, as we read in the following verse. "The life of this world is but play and amusement." The Holy Quran, chapter 47, verse 36. Also, consider the following verse. "What is the life of this world but play and amusement?" The Holy Quran, chapter 6, verse 32. And the following verse. "What is the life of this world but amusement and play?" Chapter 29, verse 64. And the following. "Know ye all that the life of this world is but play and amusement, pomp and mutual boasting and multiplying and rivalry among yourselves, riches and children." The Holy Quran, chapter 57, verse 20. On the contrary, many other verses in the Holy Quran see this world and everything else associated with it as good and desirable. As we read in the following verses using the Arabic word fadlihi. And if ye fear poverty soon, will God enrich you, if He wills, out of His bounty. For God is all-knowing, all-wise. The Holy Quran, chapter 9, verse 28. And thou seest the ships therein that plow the waves, that ye may seek thus of the bounty of God. The Holy Quran, chapter 16, verse 14. Nor those who are niggardly or enjoin niggardliness on others, or hide the bounties which God hath bestowed on them. The Holy Quran, chapter 4, verse 37. Were it not for the grace and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on you, in this world and the hereafter, a grievous penalty would have seized you in that ye rushed glibly into this affair. The Holy Quran, chapter 24, verse 14. Time for a short break. Stay tuned. Welcome back, my dear respectful viewers. This world doesn't have to be considered a dark place. This world is a place of opportunity where one can live happily and build themselves a record for the hereafter. Imam Ali, the commander of the faithful, alayhi salam, said, the world is a trade center for God's friends. The noble prophet, alayhi salam, said, the world is a farm for the hereafter. He also said, the world is the best aid for the hereafter. He also said, how good is wealth for a good servant? Thus, we can conclude that this world is an intermediate step and a means to reach the hereafter. The phrases trade center and farm and helper used in these traditions to refer to the world imply that one cannot attain prosperity in the hereafter without using the life of this world. However, if we forget the role of this world and consider it the ultimate goal for man, then we will become negligent and seek our absolute welfare in this world. The Holy Quran says, if God were to enlarge the provisions for His servants, they would indeed transgress beyond all bounds through the earth. The Holy Quran, chapter 42, verse 47. All men like wealth. Is this love for wealth and motivation to own a part of man's nature, or is it an acquired form of behavior? Some people believe this to be a part of man's nature, since even animals have an instinct to own which can be observed from their behavior. Some scientists consider this love for ownership not to be an independent instinctive force. Rather, they think it is a means by which man can fulfill other instinctive needs such as eating, clothing, housing, sex, and childbearing. Animals exert their ownership over subjects that they need for specific purposes. The various forms of this ownership can be seen regarding their food, companions, and nest or a place to live. The tendency to own is stronger in animals regarding their stronger inclinations such as hunger, sex, and childbearing. William James considered ownership to be a form of social expression of personality or a form of psychological volumetric expansion. He said the word does not imply my psychological forces only, rather it also includes my clothes, my house, my automobile, my property, my bank, etc. All these things arouse the same senses in me. Even though the love for wealth is not instinctive, it has slowly become a value in the society since wealth can help fulfill many of the man's desires. The Holy Quran says, and violent is he in his love of wealth. The Holy Quran, chapter 100, verse 8. Regarding this matter, Imam Al-Sadiq alayhi salam said, there is no good in one who does not like to legitimately earn wealth to safeguard his honor, pay back his debts, and establish the bonds of kinship. Once the Prophet of God Muhammad, peace be upon him, his pure progeny, was sitting with a few of his companions. He saw a strong young man who was working hard and had been working since dawn. The companions expressed their unhappiness about the man's act and said, we wish this young man used his strength and the youth in God's way. The Prophet said, no, do not say this. If he is working so hard in order to prevent himself from asking from people and to be free of need of them, then he is working in God's way. If he is working hard to fulfill the needs of his weak parents or children to make them free of need, then he is working in God's way. However, if he is working hard to collect a lot of wealth and show off to others, then he is working in Satan's way. Thus, we realize that whoever works hard to fulfill his needs and safeguard his honor is serving God subhanahu wa ta'ala, and such acts of earning wealth are not only but blameworthy, but are considered to be a duty for every man as well. The deeds and types of behavior of the Immaculate Imams, peace be upon them all, are a strong document to support this. Let us read what Muhammad ibn Muqaddir said about Imam al-Baqir. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam said that Muhammad ibn Muqaddir once said, "I did not think that Ali ibn al-Husayn would appoint a better leader after himself. However, once I saw his son Muhammad ibn Ali and decided to advise him. However, it turned out that he advised me instead. I was in the outskirts of Medina on a very hot day when I saw him working on the farm. I asked myself why such an old man from the Quraysh tribe is working so hard seeking wealth on such a hot day. After greeting him, I asked why he was working so hard seeking worldly gains. I said, 'May God improve your condition. Why is a noble man from the Quraysh tribe seeking worldly gains at this time of day? What would happen to you if the angel of death comes to take your life in this condition?' Then he greeted back and said, 'If the angel of death arrives while I am working so hard as I am doing now in order to earn a living for myself and children so that I do not have to beg from you for my needs, then I will be found in a state of servitude of God. I should be worried to be caught by the angel of death in a sinful state.' Then I said, 'Yes, you are right. May God have mercy on you. I wanted to advise you, but you were the one who gave me advice.' Thus, we see that our religious leaders made an effort to earn their living so that they did not have to ask others for what they needed. They also taught their followers to earn their own living and not beg. Those who are working to earn a living for themselves, their wife, and children are considered to be in the ranks of those who participate in the holy war in Islam. Imam Sadiq alayhi salam said, 'Whoever strives to earn a living for his wife is like one who is fighting in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In addition, one who abandons his wife and does not fulfill her needs is deprived of God's mercy.' The noble prophet of Allah Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, 'Cursed is the one who neglects his dependents.' We have reached the end of this episode. Stay tuned for another episode on the Treatise of Rights series with me, your host, Ali Jasim. Thank you all for watching, and may Allah hasten the reappearance of our beloved Imam al-Mahdi, ajala ta'ala farajahu al-sharif. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.